Hi, I'm John Pace, a member of the R.M. Santilli Foundation and the chairman of this World Lecture Series on Hadronic Mathematics, Mechanics, and Chemistry. It is my pleasure and honor for me to introduce Professor Ruggero Maria Santilli, who will present in this first lecture a conceptual summary of the mathematical, theoretical, experimental, and industrial evidence accumulated over 50 years of research by numerous scholars. The evidence deals with the exact validity of Einstein's special relativity under the conditions of its original conception, in empty space, while for more complex physical conditions, special relativity is only approximately valid. A necessary prerequisite for the understanding of this lecture is an in-depth knowledge of the mathematical, physical, and experimental branches of special relativity. This World Lecture Series comprises talks by Professor Santilli, as well as by numerous outstanding scholars from various countries. The lectures are classified into 5 levels. Level 1 includes introductory lectures such as this one. Level 2 includes lectures in pure and applied mathematics. Level 3 includes lectures in theoretical and applied physics. Level 4 includes lectures in theoretical and applied chemistry. And level 5 includes lectures on experimental verifications and industrial applications. Among the various lectures of this series, those directly related to special relativity are the following ones. The first lecture, 1A, on the limitations of the theory. Lectures 2A and 2B on the new mathematics needed to resolve the said limitations. Lecture 3A and 3B on Santilli covering relativity for physical media, and Lecture 5A on the experimental verifications of deviations from the Doppler's law within physical media and their applications to cosmology. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you Professor Santilli.
Let me begin by stating the obvious, namely that the entire science of the 20th century has been dominated by one name and one name only, namely by Albert Einstein. And this dominance has been, of course, for very good reason. Indeed, I have often stated in my work that special relativity as a majestic axiomatic structure, as well as a truly impressive body of experimental verification. And so I don't have to remind to my colleagues the beauty, validity of special relativity at this time. Also allow me to remind the power of the name Albert Einstein, because it can be illustrated by remembering the experimental verification of the energy equivalence, the famous equation E equals mc squared, via the atomic bomb. And so therefore it is understandable that the entire scientific community has been really dominated by the power of this colossal scientist of the 20th century. However, the all energy and fuels that could be identified with Einstein theory were all well known by the middle of the 20th century, and they were known to be environmentally unacceptable or insufficient or had environmental problem, because they either released harmful radiation or they released harmful radioactive waste or for other environmental reasons. So it is known by technicians, that expert in the field, that the only possibility for mankind to really come up with fundamentally new, clean energy and fuels, the only possibility is to surpass Einstein theory. If we remain stagnant in the 20th century theory, then, as we will see, that we can really endanger the future of our planet. As we'll enter in today in a conceptual basis, and then in the following level by presentation by other scientists, you will see the concrete illustration of this statement via quantitative treatment and experiments. So we have a scientific duty to address the special relativity in an objective way. And the only objective way is essentially the following. We have to identify the conditions under which special relativity is exactly valid. And secondly, we have to identify the condition under which special relativity is only approximately valid. Because any theory, no matter how beautiful it is at a given time, every theory has limitations. This is extremely well known throughout the history of mankind, and it is also the fate of special relativity. Einstein himself says that Galileo relativity is valid at low speed, so it has limitation. At higher speed, my theory, Einstein said, is better. But the fate of this limitation now falls on Einstein himself. It is our duty to identify those conditions in which the special relativity is only approximately valid. And finally, we have to identify a condition under which the special relativity is inapplicable. Namely, those conditions are so far away from the condition of the original conception of special relativity that there is no science that the scientific process that you can extract, no matter how you introduce into the equation arbitrary function that then you fit from the experimental data and then you claim special relativity to be valid, a process rather often occurred, unfortunately, throughout particle physics and other physics another physics segment of the second century. So basically, in this lecture, what we will do, we will have a conceptual presentation of the level one of the aspect 1, 2, and 3. We will review the objection. Each of those three level of analysis has its own objection. We have, if we want to implement scientific democracy, we must review the objection. We will, in all level. And finally, it is our ethical duty to present or at least briefly indicate the societal implication of this type of study. Very well. Incidentally, all technical references of this lecture are available in free PDF download in the adjoining doc document that you can just click and then click on various links and you have all the references in free PDF download. Okay, let's get started then. Let's begin by identifying the condition of exact validity of special relativity. This identification is very easy. And those conditions are the original conditions stated by Einstein. They were historically called, identified as exterior dynamical condition or exterior dynamical problem, and they essentially consist of point particles and electromagnetic waves propagating in empty space, propagating in vacuum. I have to make a sharp distinction here between the original writing by Albert Einstein and the writing by Einstein followers. It's a distinction that I have to make several times during this lecture as well as in subsequent lecture, because if you look at the same condition in Einstein followers, you see difference. You see a universal applicability under whatever condition exists in the universe. And then under this type of statement, we essentially exit from a true scientific process, and we enter into academia aims, essentially. Well, here I have to present the Jovian system as an illustration of the condition of exact validity of special relativity. Because I am of Italian origin and education, I am an American citizen, of course, now, and I'm speaking as an American citizen, and indeed I have an American flag here, I carry it with me very often. Italian origin and education, I had to present the Jovian system because it was first seen by human eye by Galileo Galilei, who invented the telescope and saw the Jovian system. The Jovian system, of course, not this view, but he did see. He was the first man who saw a planetary system. Special relativity is ideally suited for an exact representation of planetary system, as it is the case for Galileo's relativity, Why? Because the central symmetry of special relativity, which is the Poincaré symmetry, or the central symmetry of Galilei relativity, which is the Galilei symmetry, they were conceived, developed, and known to apply for Keplerian system. Keplerian system are a number of massive point bodies that orbit around a heavier center, orbit in vacuum without collision around the heavier center, which is called the Keplerian center. In this case, Jupiter is the Keplerian system of the Jovian system, and the other are essentially planets orbiting around. In any case, as I said, is an obvious statement, this exact validity, because it is important to remember and note the unbelievable precision according to which NASA and Russia and China and now Europe, all the mankind sends probe at billions of kilometers distance far away from Earth with an unbelievable precision. This is evidence indeed that Galilei relativity, Newtonian mechanics, and special relativity, if we are talking about high speed, then are indeed unbelievably exact. However, as it is the case for all aspects in science, the special relativity has been the subject of very severe criticism since its inception in 1915. We cannot ignore those, otherwise we don't implement scientific democracy. We enter into theology, essentially, scientific theology. Well, first we should remember that as experts in the field are expected to know to qualify as such, that Michelson-Morley, there are a number of papers in Referee Journal claiming that the Michelson-Morley experiment is flawed or incomplete or whatever. So it is still an open issue. Why? Because the Michelson-Morley experiment has not been repeated with contemporary instrument, and the controversy will persist until that experiment is indeed redone and the issue is settled experimentally rather than by collegial authority, which is very debatable as a principle. Secondly, the notion of Einstein simultaneity has been the subject of controversy and continues to be. Additionally, I only quote five out of many. Additionally, there is very credible evidence that the speed of light is not constant for accelerated frames along a straight line. I repeat, speed of light is not expected to be constant for accelerated frames along a straight line, which means colleagues cannot jump to general relativity because there is no curvature, and any applicability of general relativity and Riemannian geometry will be essentially political. Finally, I have dedicated myself a few years of research when I was at Boston University teaching physics and mathematics at all levels, from prep courses all the way to postgraduate seminar courses in advanced applied mathematical topics. I work with Jack Agassi and Paul Roman and ask ourselves the issue, is the Poincaré symmetry the only space-time symmetry in flat space, or there are alternatives? And the answer, we came up with an alternative, which is called, today is called Agassi, Roman, Santilli, Relativistic Galilei Group. This was in 1974. 30 years and more have passed, and of course the issue is far from being completed. Indeed, there are a number of very distinguished scientists who are still studying this symmetry. Just to mention a few names, my friend, I'm honored by his friendship, Larry Horwitz at Tel Aviv University, has been seriously looking at this symmetry. John Fanke of the International Association of Relativistic Dynamics has written papers. Wilhelm and a number of others, authors, have indeed written papers. But here is, however, the important statement of we need a rock in which to build all those five levels of scientific, technical, mathematics, physics, and chemistry. And our rock is special relativity. So throughout all this lecture, at least for my lecture, I will assume special relativity to be exactly valid under the conditions stated by Einstein, namely for point particles, electromagnetic waves, propagating in vacuum. In any case, it's a pragmatic assumption because it works. We know that the Lorentz symmetry works extremely well with extreme precision when particles are being accelerated in accelerator at CERN, Fermilab, and so on. Since it works, that's good enough for us. In any case, all the mathematics and physics and chemistry that we will be working and presenting will apply with very little modification to an alternative symmetry that future physicists may identify, such as the Agassi-Roman-Santilli relativistic Galilei. The application is just very, very simple. So from now on, I will assume special relativity to be exactly valid in vacuum. Okay, now let's pass now to the second important question. Under what condition special relativity is only approximately valid? Or alternatively, do we have sufficient evidence to even consider that special relativity may be approximately valid? Yes, the answer is absolutely yes. There are many. In 50 years, we had an accumulation of mathematical, physical, chemical, experimental, industrial, and other evidence according to which special relativity cannot be valid for the so-called interior dynamical problem, such as the structure of Jupiter itself. And we are talking about what type of system are those? Those are talking about extended, therefore deformable particles and electromagnetic waves propagating within a physical medium. Think about light propagating in our atmosphere, or think about the atoms of Jupiter that they propagate through another medium, and many, many other systems that are now this approximate character of special relativity in interior dynamical problem is crucial for the prediction and quantitative treatment of new clean energies and fuels. So therefore, if we ignore a scientific analysis of the limitation of special relativity, certainly we can get chairs and all sorts of grants and maybe big prizes, but the issue persists. Do we serve really society, or we abuse society for personal aims? So there is an ethical duty underlining this issue. But the point, now we will investigate the statement in all, as I indicated, in all levels, mathematical, physics, chemical, experimental, industrial, and you will see all this massive evidence. At this moment, there is no need for colleagues in good faith to look at the evidence because the fundamental notions are conceptual. The technical treatment then is only consequential. Just look at the structure of Jupiter with a telescope. You will see vortices with a varying angular momentum. I repeat, you look at the structure with your eyes in a telescope, you see vortices in Jupiter in which the angular momentum changes in time. My dear colleague, this is direct visual evidence of the inapplicability of the rotational symmetry, which is the pillar of both Poincaré and the Galilei symmetry. So if the rotational symmetry at the foundation of both Galilei and special relativity is inapplicable. I don't use the word violation. Will be a lack of respect over Einstein and Galileo. Einstein and Galileo did not conceive their theory for the vortices inside Jupiter. So to use the word violation will be very irrespectful, and I object strongly. I use inapplicable. So if the rotational symmetry is inapplicable in the interior structures of just Jupiter, how can anybody claim the exact validity of Galilei in special relativity? But let's look at the preceding view from classical viewpoint. Let's look at from an operator viewpoint. This is the view of the sun. Ladies and gentlemen, how can we possibly believe that relativistic quantum mechanics, which is a magnificent symbiotic combination of quantum mechanics and special relativity, and which works beautifully for the structure of the atom, hydrogen atom, for instance, how can the same theory be assumed for certain to be exactly valid in the core of a star? There are the objections are countless. First of all, The relativistic quantum mechanics necessarily must use the theory of linear operator on a Hilbert space, linear operator on Hilbert space on an hyperdense furnace like this, ladies and gentlemen, at that moment I depart from my colleagues. Sorry, I have to do it my way, because I cannot possibly accept such a simplistic structure for such an incredibly complex physical problem, such as the structure of the sun. In any case, I cannot accept the word quantum, as we will see probably in the lecture 1b. I cannot possibly accept the word quantum, because I do see the quantum of energy in an electron jumping orbit in the structure of the hydrogen atom. Yes, that I see. That's where there is no objection. But when the same electron is in the core of a star, it cannot jump. We cannot assume absorb any energy in any quantized way at all. As we will see technically, when we replace the theory of linear operator in highly non-linear, non-local, non-Hamiltonian, etc., it will be inevitable to replace Planck constant with an integral differential operator that will represent indeed the possibility of a continuous absorption of energy in the core of a star. Certainly not quantized. Quantized is it becomes a trivial particular case, valid when at the limit all the constituents of the sun are separated in vacuum, like in the structure of the hydrogen atom. It was at the beginning of the creation of the sun. So, but there are objections, despite the evidence that we will see. I have to repeat, mathematical, conceptual, mathematical, physical, chemical, experimental, and industrial level of the approximate character of special relativity and Galilei relativity for the interior problem, there are many, many objections which we have to review. The most known objection is that these deviations essentially are apparent, quote unquote. This is stated even in referee papers in American Physical Society and review books and so on by famous scientists belonging to very famous institutions. No point in having names here. They claim that it's apparent because when the sun or Jupiter, those interior dynamical problems are reduced to their elementary particle constituents, the elementary particle move in vacuum, and in this case, therefore, special relativity and quantum mechanics is regained in its entirety. And indeed, this is the very reason why, before Einstein, there was a clear separation between exterior and interior dynamical problems. And then, with the advent of Einstein theory, this distinction was terminated. And even the names interior and exterior dynamical problems have disappeared from the literature of the second part of the 20th century. Indeed, it is important to remember as an example that Schwarzschild wrote two very important articles. One article entitled The Solution of the Exterior Gravitational Problem, but is famous, of course, and now written in history. But he also wrote a second article that has been ignored throughout the 20th century by most, but not all. And the second article was on the interior problem, solution of the interior problem. The second article has been essentially ignored because it deviates from general relativity quite dramatically, because interior problem, as we will see, simply cannot be exactly represented with Riemannian geometry. Anyhow, so this was essentially the position of the 20th century science, that all interior problems can be reduced to elementary particles and therefore moving in vacuum, and therefore quantum mechanics, special relativity, are exactly valid. Unfortunately for this very distinguished scientists who have assumed this position, they ignore the existence of a number of so-called no-reduction theorems. This is essentially one of them out of several. What we see here is a spaceship during a re-entry in our atmosphere. It's a NASA picture. Notice that the same spaceship, when it is in empty space, verify exactly Galilei relativity and high-speed special relativity. But now we are talking about interior condition inside our atmosphere. And this is clearly irreversible over time. Namely, if you revert the time, you see the spaceship exiting from our atmosphere with no force whatsoever and entering into turning back into rotation, which is, of course, beyond even the science fiction, will violate causality, energy conservation, violates all the physical law that we want. So the only causal event is one in one direction of time. Now, this no-reduction theorem states the following, that a macroscopic, irreversible system simply cannot be consistently reduced to a finite number of elementary particles, each in conservative and reversible conditions. Vice versa, if you have a finite number of elementary particles, each in reversible and conservative condition, there is no possibility whatsoever, no matter what you do, to achieve a macroscopic system which is irreversible. This theorem is proved nowadays by first-year graduate students in various universities, although the existence of those no-reduction theorem continues to be kept secret, hidden, intentionally, apparently, in certain cases, in a number of PhD courses, because it clearly casts shadow on the limitation of special relativity, and it's the way it is currently presented in a number, but not all, graduate school, the way the special relativity is presented as applicable under special relativity and quantum mechanics, therefore relativistic quantum mechanics will be applicable under whatever condition exists in the universe, with no limitation mentioned whatsoever to the best of my knowledge. Therefore, suppressing the creativity of the students rather than enhancing it. In any case, you should know that by far the supporter of special relativity reached truly unbelievable limits of theology with respect to the light, because light is the very heart of special relativity. So any attack on light is defended by Einstein follower in an unbelievable, truly unbelievable way. What is the argument of the Einstein followers, not Einstein? The argument of Einstein followers is that you reduce light to photons. Photons, this light is an angle of refraction. Light enters into water in this glass and then comes out. So the Einstein follower claim that you reduce light to photon. Photons are scattered among the water molecule, are absorbed and then re-emitted. And since the photons propagate in empty space, so they claim that special relativity absolutely is 100% exact for light propagating in water, even to the speed of light in water, as you expect, is reduced to about two-thirds that in light. There is one-third loss of the speed of light. Despite that, they say, no, it's exactly valid. Unfortunately, this is a posturing that's been kept for almost a century. At the end of the past century, the number of physicists have kept this posture in complete oblivion of a number of inconsistency, some of which catastrophic, connected to this posturing that have been published in refereed journals. Now, first of all, the number of them is many. I'll try to summarize a few. Remember, science, true serious science, is a quantitative process. Namely, we have to study a given phenomenon, in this case light, with appropriate mathematics. This mathematics has to produce numbers, and those numbers have to be verified with experiments. If you don't have those two steps, mathematical treatment, numerical prediction, and experimental verification, we're talking about at best conjecture, theology, idea, or whatever. Now, what is very well known and proved in referee technical journal is that if you reduce light to photons, there is no possibility whatsoever, none, of representing numerically the angle of refraction. It's obvious, the reason is obvious, because photons will, when they hit the surface of the water, they will scatter in all directions. And there is no reason whatsoever, unless it is by will, unless it is to adapt reality to a preferred theory, but that's not science. And there is no possibility whatsoever that all the photons, they bend and follow this new straight line. There is no possibility. Also, it's known to any graduate school that really cares about scientific truth rather than theologies. It's known that by reducing light propagating in water, there is no possibility whatsoever to represent numerically the reduction of one-third. At best, you could get 2 or 3%. By throwing free parameters, throwing arbitrary function, try to adapt all these things that are very familiar, unfortunately for mankind, in the most advanced physics department and laboratory, at best you may reach 5%, 6% by all crazy stretching, but not 33% reduction of the speed of light. And then there are additional inconsistency. For instance, let's assume okay that with some manipulation which is unknown, light can indeed be reduced to photon, and photon mysteriously, we don't know why, but somebody may in the future discover how eventually they explain this angle of refraction. Let's assume that is possible with some totally unknown manipulation. But then what to represent the light propagating in a straight line in water, you need an enormous number of photons, 10 to the 30, 10 to the 40 photons, entering through an enormous number of atoms and nuclei, penetrating through with no scattering and coming out in a straight line, because this is a straight line. This is, ladies and gentlemen, is beyond any level of credibility. Finally, why I never accepted the reduction of all frequencies to photons since my day in the graduate schools at the University of Torino in the middle of the 1960s, for a very simple reason, that this behavior, this experimental evidence, applies to all frequency, including radio waves. So for me to accept the reduction of photons for all possible light, all possible electromagnetic waves, this was a question I asked to my teacher at the University of Torino. Of course, I had problems because of the question. I asked, tell me how I can possibly reduce to photons an electromagnetic wave which has 1 meter wavelength. My dear colleagues, this is not possible. So that's the point of departure in which I do not intend to be associated to theological position, posturing that are intentionally conceived to adapt. Here is an event beyond Einstein times to a preferred theory, which is which is special relativity. In closing, I would like to separate Einstein from Einstein followers. I intend to honor Einstein. Einstein received a Nobel Prize for his hypothesis of the photon, that was indeed experimentally verified, and his existence of photons is beyond doubt. As a matter of fact, in my writing, I indicated that Einstein should have gotten at least 2 Nobel Prizes. He got only one, but it's good enough. But now, Einstein is a serious scientist. What he wrote that this photon hypothesis applies only to those frequencies or wavelength in which there can be an absorption of light by the black body, system, namely the, basically the frequency, the wavelength have to be close to the quantum energy for a quantum jump. Now, if you use Einstein's original paper, not the version written by Einstein followers, there's an enormous difference. If you use Einstein's original paper, you represent quantitatively what you see here is a reduction of the intensity of light. This reduction of the intensity of light is precisely another experimental verification why Einstein justly got the Nobel Prize. Because this light has been absorbed by the atoms of the water. The point now, where I cannot follow the Einstein followers, when they expand, for evident theological, sometimes political reason, when they extend this beautiful achievement by Albert Einstein, they extend it to all possible frequencies. And that's where, I'm sorry, I cannot follow them anymore. And I do research in my way by always honoring Albert Einstein.